The words of Jesus are not rhetoric. You know, we speak rhetorically. Even when you preach, sometimes you say certain things which are not really 100% correct. You take all the messages of all the preachers and you evaluate it theologically. Sometimes in the moment of getting carried away, you might say something which is not 100% theologically correct. But Yeshua is different. He was not rhetoric. He was not theological. He was God, for goodness sake. He was God. So the words He said are very, I mean, they are life and they are truth. The words that I speak unto you, He said, are life and they are truth. So the words of Jesus are very powerful. So one such statement that He made, you know, I'm studying at the moment, I'm preparing a series called Greater Than. Greater Than. Because there are so many instances in the Bible where Jesus said, greater than. Today we're just going to look at one of those instances. Greater than the temple. That's the theme of this message today. Greater than the temple. Greater than the temple. There you have it there. Right, so what the Lord was saying to the Pharisees and the scribes and the religious leaders of that time is that there's something or as a person who's greater than the temple. But before we go there, let's understand what the temple means. What is the temple? What is the temple? Exodus chapter 25. Exodus 25. You know, in the wilderness, the Lord commanded Moses to set up a tabernacle. It is called the Tabernacle of Meetings. It is also called the Wilderness Tabernacle. And in that place, in quotes, in that place I will meet you. I will speak to you. I will command you, the Lord said to Israel. And He told Moses very explicit, very clear details of how the tabernacle should be built. How the tabernacle should be built. And in Exodus 25, in Exodus 25, I'll read some scriptures. Verse 22. And there I will meet with you. What's he talking about? He's saying, there I will meet with you. And he said, I'm reading from the Bible. And there I will meet with you and I will speak with you from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubim, which are on the ark of the testimony. About everything which I will give you in commandment to the children of Israel. So the Lord was saying about this specific place. Now if you look at the picture up there, there is the Ark of the Covenant and the two golden cherubims right on top and the mercy seat in the middle. And the Lord said, I will speak to you from above the mercy seat between the golden cherubims. Right? So He mentioned a place where I will speak with you. I will be above the mercy seat. It'll be between the cherubims. And He said, I will speak everything which I need to command Israel. You know what Moses needs to command Israel. So this was an awesome sight. This was something very powerful where the presence of God would come into the very tabernacle of God which Moses prepared. It was an ordinary thing. It was made of material from the earth. Nothing came from heaven. But there were representations of some things that were in heaven. And God's presence would be there. So scary was the presence of God that the high priest who would go in on behalf of the sins of the people on the Day of Atonement. He would go with the blood sacrifice. And if the high priest was not worthy, he would drop down dead. And that was the powerful presence of God. Now this is the tabernacle. This is the tabernacle. But what happened is when they came into the promised land and, time passed, the passage of time, I'm quoting Kamala Harris, the passage of time. As time went on, they came into the promised land and then David wanted to build a temple of praise. We sang that song, Rebuilding the Temple of Praise. Who built the temple? Who built the temple? I'm going to disrupt your theology today. Who built the temple? Anyone? Come on, church. Talk to me. Who built the church? Who built the temple? Yes? Solomon? Now I'm going to dispute with you now. Anyone else? Solomon was the Basun Nahe. Yeah, it's called Solomon's Temple. But actually, in my heart, in my opinion, David built the temple. Right? I know the Bible says Solomon did this, Solomon did that. Yeah, it's called Solomon's Temple. Physically, Solomon built the temple. But everything begins with a vision. Everything begins with something that you see. And who had the desire to build the temple? David. Who was David? A messianic king who was a representation of the Messiah himself. What does the Bible talk about the end time temple? It talks about the praise, the temple of David. It talks about the tabernacle of David. There is no tabernacle of David in the Old Testament. The Lord said prophetically, in the end times, I will restore the tabernacle of David. There is no tabernacle of David. Because he had the heart, he had the vision, he had the stirring. And Solomon built the temple. The Lord told David, no, David, there's too much blood on your hands, so you cannot build the temple. But your son after you, Solomon, will build the temple. And you know, the temple was so glorious. Let's move on. 1 Kings chapter 1 Kings chapter 1. Okay, before that, I will read a few other scriptures also before I go to 1 Kings. Before I go to the temple, I'll also read the same reference in Exodus chapter 29. I want to highlight these words. That's why I'm going. It's sometimes a repetition, but highlight these words. Exodus 29, again talking about the temple. The tabernacle. Exodus 29 verse 42. This shall be a continual burnt offering throughout your generations at the door of the tabernacle of meetings before the Lord, where I will meet with you and speak with you. And there I will meet the children of Israel, and the tabernacle shall be sanctified by my glory. There was blood that had to be applied, but the ultimate sanctification of the temple was by the glory of God. Right? So, let's read, go to the last part of Exodus, chapter 40. After they built the tabernacle, chapter 40. I'll read verse 34. Then the cloud covered the tabernacle of meetings, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tabernacle of meetings because the cloud rested above it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Now, this is the same Moses who went up into Sinai, into the same cloud. He received the commandments from God, and he spoke to God face to face as a man would talk to his friend. The same Moses was now not able to enter that tabernacle because the glory cloud has come down and sanctified the temple. Now, whenever we talk of the temple, now we call this a temple, the house of God. We don't see glory in the house of God these days. So you need smoke machines to put up a smoke. You know, but in the Old Testament tabernacle, God's glory filled and sanctified the temple. Right? The important thing is that Moses finished the work. Moses finished the work. Look what's up there. Moses finished the work. And he had to do it in a certain pattern. And he did it according to the certain pattern, Exodus 25, 9. And then the glory filled the tabernacle. The glory filled the tabernacle. And Moses could not enter. Now, this is how God sanctified the temple. Let's move on now to the book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 8. When they came to the promised land, you know the story. Solomon, David desired to build the temple. The Lord said no. And then Solomon eventually built the temple. Chapter 8. before chapter 8, I'll read chapter 7, verse 51. So all the work that King Solomon had done for the house of the Lord was finished. Remember, Moses finished the work. So here is Solomon finishing the work. And Solomon brought in all the things which his father David had dedicated. Who built the temple? Okay, David had dedicated. The silver, the gold, and the furnishings, he put them in the treasuries of the house of the Lord. Now Solomon assembled, chapter 8. Now Solomon assembled the elders of Israel and all the heads of the tribes and the chief fathers of the children of Israel and King Solomon to King Solomon in Jerusalem. So he assembled, he finished, he assembled the people. And then let's go skip on and go to verse 10. Verse 10. And it came to pass when the priest came out of the holy place, the cloud filled the house of the Lord so that the priest could not continue ministering because of the cloud, for the glory of the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. And then Solomon prayed that amazing, famous prayer. You know, while I was putting down this slide, I got this picture from the internet. And I was honestly fearing inside. I asked the Lord, is it okay if I put this picture? You know, I felt the presence of God so powerful, so awesome, that I was afraid. You know, we are not supposed to take pictures. We are not supposed to superimpose or produce something that is in heaven. But this is on the earth. But you know, that thought came to me. I said, Lord, I don't know, you're not saying anything. So forgive me. Forgive me if this is not right. You know, because it's an awesome thing when you mess with the presence of God. When you get into the presence of God, when you actually sense the presence of God, and when you see God beginning to do something, it creates a little fear of God. This is not that you're scared of God, but you know, it's nothing wrong in being scared of God. David was afraid of God. When something happened, I'm not talking about the fear of God. That's a different thing. David was afraid of God when those two men tried to, you know, steady the Ark of the Covenant, and they were struck down. One was struck down. I don't know, IO or something like that. That man was struck dead. And, you know, David was afraid of the Lord that day. Moses, when he saw the mountain covered with flame and cloud and fire, he said, I fear and tremble exceedingly. Today we come into the house of God without any fear, without any trembling. We read a portion of scripture today from Isaiah. I'm going to read that again in a little while. But see, the Jerusalem temple was sanctified in this manner. The glory of the Lord came down. Why did the glory come down? Because they did exactly what the Lord had told them. The exact way, the silver, the gold, the instruments, the apparatus of the temple, everything had to be made the way the Lord said. The right animal skin, the right shedding of blood, everything had to be in the right way. And when it was done, finished according to God's pattern, then God's presence came. You know, this is a lesson to us. Our lives has to be according to the pattern that God gave. Where is that pattern? Where is that pattern? You want a pattern for your life? Where is the pattern? Come on, talk to me. Where is the pattern for God's for your life? Where is it? No, it's not in High magazine. It's not in the fashion magazines, no. It's not in the great leadership manuals that people have written. It's in none of those things. But it is in the Word of God. The Word of God is a manual for your life. I feel even afraid to say manual. You know, it's the Word of God. It's God. So that everything pertaining to your life. Somebody asked me, where is the book of life? I said, I don't know. I think the Bible is the book of life. Because I see there are names in the Bible which have meanings. There are Old Testament names, New Testament names of people. And I dare say that your name is also in the Bible. I will not go there right now. So, getting back to the tabernacle. Look at the little notes which I put there at the bottom of the picture. The first temple built by King Solomon in the 10th century BC, somewhere around 18 BC actually. It was located on the Temple Mount. Now, those of you who don't know the Bible, when you read the news, you are also wondering, why is Israel having all these problems? Why are they clashing? Why are they fighting? This is the reason. The first temple was dedicated on the Temple Mount. Today, you know what's on the Temple Mount? There is an Al-Aqsa Mosque. There's no temple there. You know what else happened on the Temple Mount? Abraham sacrificed Isaac, or he went to sacrifice Isaac on Mount Moriah, the same mountain. What has happened on Mount Moriah? The crucifixion, Golgotha, the same place. So the Lord is particular when he comes onto the earth to do something. He's particular about the place. And that is why he said to Solomon, I will come to the place. I will meet you in this place. So the first temple was built by Solomon. That is the fulfillment of the wilderness tabernacle as a permanent structure in Jerusalem, in the temple, on the Temple Mount. This temple was destroyed by the Babylonians in 587 BC. Who were the Babylonians? The world empire of that time. They destroyed the temple, 587 BC. The temple was rebuilt in the first century before Christ. It was rebuilt and rebuilt by Zerubbabel. The book, the Old Testament, the minor prophets write about the restoration of the temple. But that was not a great rebuilding of the temple. But Herod the Great, he restored the temple because he wanted to have the favor of the Jews. So see, he knew that the temple was an important place. So he restored the temple very beautiful, gloriously. He restored it. And it's the same temple that Jesus and the disciples walked around. And the disciples marveled at the temple and they told Jesus, can you see this beautiful temple? Jesus said, you pull it down and I will build it in 3 days. They said, oh, it has taken such a long time. How can you say that you're going to build it in 3 days? The Jews didn't understand the importance of this temple. They didn't understand the significance of the temple. To them, it was a lot of outward religion and excitement. Today, our lives can be the same. We come into church, we go home, we listen to praise songs, we listen to worship. We do good things, we don't do anything bad. But is that enough? Is that enough? Why do you come to church today? Why did you come to church today? Sorry, I'm not being rude. But why did you come to church? Why won't you come tomorrow? Why did you come today? Come on, talk to me. Because it's Sunday. And that's what you do on Sunday. You come to church on Sunday. Right? You won't come tomorrow because there is no service tomorrow. There is no music. There is no singing. You won't come to church tomorrow. So we have got into this thing. Oh, Sunday we go to church. Saturday we do this. Friday we do that. The Jews were no different. The Jews were no different. This place which God sanctified by His Holy Spirit, by His glory, had become a place just like that. So the disciples looked at the place and said, oh, wonderful buildings. Jesus said, no, I can build it in 3 days. They didn't understand what he was talking about. Let's turn to Matthew 12 now. I'll read from verse 1. At the time, Jesus went through the grain fields on the Sabbath, and his disciples were hungry and began to pluck the heads of grain and eat. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to him, look, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on Sunday. No, I'm paraphrasing there. Not, they're doing something that's not lawful to do on Sunday or Sabbath. But he said to them, have you not read that what David did when he was hungry? He and those who were with him, how he entered the house of God and ate the shewbread, which is not lawful for him to eat, nor for those who were with him, but only the priests. Or have you not read in the law that the Shabbat and the priests in the temple profane the Shabbat and are blameless. Yet I say to you that in this place, there is one greater than the temple. But if you had known what this means, and then in quotes, I desire mercy, not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is the Lord even of the Shabbat. Now they're bringing the days. They're bringing the observances. This is the religion of the Pharisees. They're bringing the days, the application of the days, the feasts, the temple. They're bringing those things and trying to educate Jesus. Because Jesus' disciples had plucked the grain from the fields and eaten on the Shabbat. Shabbat, you're not supposed to work. They were hungry. They plucked the grains and ate. Picking the grain is harvest. Oh, you're not supposed to harvest on the Shabbat. You know, religion has gone to that extreme. And you know what they said? Keep your finger on 12 and go to chapter 9. There are two stories here. Chapter 9. I'll read from chapter 9, verse 3. And at once some of the scribes said within themselves, this man blasphemes. Now, why did they say that? Because he forgave the sin of a man who was a paralytic. He said, your sins are forgiven. And they said in verse 3, at some of the scribes said within themselves, this man blasphemes. But Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, why do you think evil in your hearts? Which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, arise and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. And then in verse 9, and Jesus passed from there. He saw a man named Matthew sitting in the tax office, not a good place. And he said to him, follow me. So he rose and followed him. Now it happened as Jesus sat at the table in the house that behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and sat down with the disciples. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to the disciples, why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners? Blasphemer, moving with the sinners and the tax collector. They began to accuse Jesus. And what was Jesus doing? He was seeking the lost of the house of Israel, right? So the scribes said he was blaspheming. The Pharisees accused him of being a friend of the sinners. What were they doing? They were checking Jesus along with the religious standards that they had made. And that is what he found in Matthew 12, where they said, and Jesus said something very shocking to them in verse 7. But if you had known what this means. Now, what is he talking about? Jesus is quoting a prophet, Hosea. He's quoting from prophet Hosea. Right? And that's why it's in italics and it's in quotes. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. He said, if you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. Now, Jesus is not yet condemned, not yet crucified, but Jesus is talking prophetically. He's drawing from the prophetic past. He's drawing from Hosea chapter 6, I believe. And now he's saying that if you only know what this means. In the previous story, in Matthew 9, you go down to verse 13, Matthew 9, 13. But go and learn what this means. He's saying the same thing to the set of scribes here. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. So go and learn what it means. In Matthew 12, he said, if you had known what this means. He's talking past tense. If you had known what this means, you would not have condemned the guiltless. They are the ones who condemned Jesus to death. You would not have had done this. Past tense. In Matthew 9, he says, go and learn what this means. But in both instances, he quotes the same scripture. Now, if he's quoted the scripture, what should you and I do? We should go to that scripture. So let's go to the scripture. Hosea chapter 6. Come and let us return to the Lord. Come and let us return to the Lord. Now this is Hosea, one of the minor prophets who came after Daniel. And he was talking some centuries before Christ. And he's talking about Israel. Now by this time, Israel has been overrun by the enemy, taken over by the Babylonians. They have lost their temple. They have lost all the presence of God. They have lost that glory, the power, the cloud of glory, the voice of God. They have lost all those things. And then Hosea says, let us return to the Lord. For he has torn, but he will heal. He has stricken, but he will bind us up. After 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise us up. What is he talking about? Is Hosea talking about the resurrection? Jesus has not even come yet in Hosea's time. But Hosea is saying, in 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise us up. Obviously, he's talking about the death and resurrection of Christ. But beyond that, remember, he's prophesying to Israel. He's prophesying to Israel. So messianic prophecies, the prophecies of the Old Testament prophets, they have a twofold meaning. They can apply to Israel. They can also apply to the church. Then they can apply to an immediate event, but they can also prophetically apply to an event in the future. So, as Hosea spoke, let's read on. That we may live, verse 3. Let us know, let us pursue the knowledge of the Lord. His going forth is established as the morning. He will come like the rain, like the latter rain and the former rain on the earth. O Ephraim, Ephraim is the Lord sometimes calls Israel Ephraim because of the son, Jacob's son. O Ephraim, what shall I do to you? O Judah, that's another son. What shall I do to you? For your faithfulness is like the morning cloud, and your early dew goes away. Therefore, I have hewn them by the prophets. I have slain them by the words of my mouth. Your judgments are like the light that goes forth. For I desire mercy and not sacrifice. This is the verse that Jesus quoted in both instances. In both instances, he quoted this same scripture. Why did he quote this same scripture? Because he was talking about the prophecy of Hosea, where Hosea said, Hosea prophetically spoke about two days and 3 days, or the third day. 2 days and the third day. You can apply that to days. You can also apply to years as far as Israel is concerned. I'll show you that in a little bit. But the thing he said is, I desire mercy. And he went on to say, the latter part of verse 6, for I desire mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings. You know, they had gone so much into the burnt offerings, the dead sacrifices, and they have lived all their lives like that. After a while, at the time of Christ, they had forgotten even God. They had forgotten to connect with the live prophecy. But they're living with the dead sacrifices, the burnt offerings. Today, if you and I just continue doing the same old thing, not expecting anything to change, you are bringing burnt offerings. You're living in the old, something that has been archived and passed away. But God is looking to the church to bring his glory to bear upon the church. So when Jesus said these things, he said something very prophetic and very powerful. Let's move on. You know, the Jews had a lot to do with the temple. Look at what that heading says. The rebuke of Jesus. Jesus rebuked those people, the scribes and the Pharisees. In order to understand what Jesus is saying, you have to understand the prophetic. And the temples tell the story. That's what I've told you there. The Jews lived through two temples. I showed you the graph earlier. I showed you the two temples. The first temple was the temple built by Solomon, or David if you like. It was a replica of the wilderness tabernacle. That was the first temple. Later on, after the temple was destroyed by the Babylonians, Zerubbabel, a man called Zerubbabel, built the temple again because of the burden that God gave the Jews to return. And a Persian king, Cyrus, allowed them to return to Jerusalem and build the temple. So Zerubbabel built some sort of a temple. But as the time went on and it came to the time of Christ, or just before the time of Christ, in 18 BC to be precise, King Herod, or Herod the Great, restored, or he built a massive edifice on the Temple Mount, and that was the second temple. 2 days, 2,000 years, two temples. The temples tell us a story. Two temples. They have lived past two temples. Look at the bottom line. Not the one is highlighted. Look at the bottom line. The third temple will be built before the Antichrist appears. You know the reason? In Matthew 24 and in Daniel chapter 9, the Lord told us about the abomination that causes desolation. Or the abomination. You know, the abominations are referred to as the pagan gods, the Baals, the Ashtaroths, and all those pagan gods which they worship, the demonic gods. God called them an abomination. But the Lord said, one day that abomination will come into the temple and sit in the holy place. Daniel prophesied that in Daniel chapter 9. Jesus spoke about it in Matthew 24. In the Olivet Discourse, when he was talking about the end times, he said, let him that reads understand. A similar thing to what the Lord said to the scribes and the Pharisees about Hosea. Jesus quoted Daniel and said, let him that reads understand. Because there is something that's going to happen. The third temple is going to arrive on the scene. The third day, he will raise us up. Third day, Jesus rose from the dead. Right. So, the third temple is future. You might say, oh, it's going to take a long time. Leave it to the Jews. Prefabrication. They've already done the designs. They're already raising the red heifers, you know, that kind of calf that had to be sacrificed. I am told that the instruments for the temple are all already made and ready. In 2024, early 2024, one of the leaders in the Jewish parliament had said, let's build the temple. Just like that. Let's build the temple. You know, they are not an ordinary secular people. They are a people of God. Even in the fallen state. Paul said even their fallen state, they are a blessing to the world. Imagine what it would be if they had not fallen. Right? So, the temple is going to be built. Don't worry about that. Every Messianic Jew believes that. The Orthodox Jews believe it, but they have a problem with the Messianic Jews. So there's a division. Like we have in the Christian denominations. They have the denomination. They have the divisions. But you know what? It has to do with God. Amen? And what God said will be fulfilled. On the third day, he will raise us up. The third temple. Let's read what is in the yellow bar there. Israel was torn, stricken, until they returned to the Lord. That's what we read from Hosea. They rejected the Messiah. 2 days, 2 millennia, 2,000 years after Christ's advent. The third temple is after the Great Tribulation. Now I'll show you something graphically. Just to tell you, here is a little timeline. You see the first two bars, which are in orange, which is the call of Abraham. That's the beginning of Israel, Genesis chapter 12. The second orange bar is Israel as a nation, coming from the above, the Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the 12 tribes, Joseph, and later on Moses, who built the tabernacle. So somewhere in that second bar, the first temple was built, because the kings also come under that second bar. Right, and towards the end of the second bar, the second temple was built by Herod, 18 BC, 18 years before Christ. Right, then Christ came. The advent of Christ happened in that gap where you see a cross, and then the crucifixion happened. And that event After the crucifixion, on the third day, we have the resurrection and the beginning of the church. So the church has already experienced the third day. You and I are supposed to walk in the third day. What does it mean to walk in the third day? It means to walk in the resurrection. To walk in the resurrection and experience in the resurrection power, in the resurrection glory. So you don't need a temple. You don't need the smoke. You don't need the presence of God to come down in a smoke over the temple. You are the temple. Amen? You are resurrected. You are resurrected. Therefore, Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ, yet I live. You are resurrected from the dead. So the middle bar, which talks about the church, begins with the resurrection, and then the church bar ends at the rapture, where the church is no more on the earth. Revelation chapter 4. There's no more mention of the word church after Revelation chapter 4, because that is end times. After that, what happens is a red bar, which is the 7 years of tribulation. It's called Jacob's trouble because that is the greatest punishment that God is going to permit on Israel. But you know the good news, that during that time, Israel is going to repent. Israel is going to repent. There's going to be the prophets appearing. 144,000 Jews are going to be sealed during that time. And they are going to become the preachers. You know, we sometimes get it into our heads that, oh, we have to preach. The church has to preach. Yes, the church can preach. But the Jews are also going to preach. Even an angel is going to come down from heaven with the everlasting gospel. So you and I are not just the only people. You know what has gone wrong with the church? We are not preaching the gospel. We are doing the religion of scribes and the Pharisees. The Bible says, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all, and then shall the end come. When did you hear the gospel of the kingdom preached? You have a gospel of salvation. You have a gospel of healing. You have a gospel of prosperity. You have a gospel of blessing. Now, all those have a part. But the main thing is the kingdom. What is the kingdom? If you don't know this, you will be like the scribes and the Pharisees. If the church doesn't know this, we will be like the scribes and the Pharisees, like the Jews when Jesus came. What will happen is you will miss out. I'm saying this with conviction. You will miss out. Don't just think just because you're in church that you're going to be caught away. I fear and tremble when I read the scriptures, because the Bible is not talking about this thing that happens on a Sunday. The Bible is talking about, you know, the people who received that glory on Mount Sinai, the glory that came down on the wilderness tabernacle that sanctified the tabernacle, the glory that came down on Solomon's temple and sanctified it, and the priest could not enter. Moses could not enter the tabernacle. The priest could not enter Solomon's temple. Solomon could not enter. The builder could not enter. I'm talking about that glory. Not just coming onto this building, but coming into our lives. So that you can't enter. You can't enter. When the glory of God comes upon you as a temple, do you not know, Corinthians church, that you are a temple of the Holy Spirit? God, the Spirit of God dwells within you. You cannot enter. You have to exit. When you exit your temple, the glory of God will fill your temple. Today our temple is full of us. The temple is full of us. You, me, I. The temple is full of us. Are you willing to empty the temple so that the glory of God can come into your temple? What happens then? What happens then? When you walk down the street, that glory cloud walks down the street. When you walk into a store, the glory of God walks in. Thieves come to your house. Oh, they see the glory. Thieves come to my house, they see padlocks. They see bars, old house, you know, they see bars, they see padlocks. They see barred windows, grills. Some houses they see dogs, watchdogs.
alarm systems, cameras. But do they see the glory? Church, this has to change. Look at the slide again. Look at the bottom two notes right at the bottom. 2 days, 2,000 years. After 2 days, he will revive us. What am I saying there? The prophetic reference here is obviously directly to the resurrection, death and resurrection of Christ, but in a more profound sense, he's talking about from the time of Christ, the middle gray arrow at the bottom, from Christ to the end of the church age is 2,000 years. We are somewhere there now. We are somewhere there towards the end of the church age. 2 days, for those 2 days, Israel is still in the process. There is a messianic group who are revived, so they are still waiting. But in between that and the millennial kingdom of Christ, the white bar, there is a great tribulation. And that is 1,000 years. So 2 plus 1 is 3. 2 days, he will revive us. On the third day, he will raise us up. Because on the third day, it is at the end of the tribulation. Look at the arrow coming down at the end of the tribulation, red bar. That's the second advent of Christ. And when Christ comes, where is he coming? He's not coming to Sri Lanka. He doesn't care that this is the pearl of the Indian Ocean. He's going to come to the place which he named, the Temple Mount, Jerusalem, down from the Mount of Olives, on the eastern side of Jerusalem, entering Jerusalem triumphantly through the eastern gate. That's how he's going to come. He's not going to ask, he's not going to apologize to anybody, because he's holding a deed in his hand, which is found in the book of Revelations, a title deed to the earth. And it's marked with a price. That price is the blood. And he's going to march in. But before we close, go to the last slide. I'm cutting short some stuff today. My message is the church cannot be like Israel. The church cannot be like Israel. Israel has more than two chances. But church has one chance. Right? But they went through hell, I'll tell you. They went through hell. Go to 1 Corinthians. You got to understand the New Testament through the Old Testament. Otherwise, to me, the New Testament is very sterile, especially the epistles. They're very sterile unless they have the full meaning. So, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that our fathers were under the cloud and passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And they ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank of the rock that followed them. That rock was Christ. Was Christ in the wilderness? Yes, he was. But with most of them, God was not well pleased, for their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now, these things became our examples, to the intent that we should not lust after evil things, as also they lusted. And do not become idolaters, as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Nor let us commit sexual immorality, as some of them did. And in one day, 23,000 fell. Nor let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed by serpents. Nor complain, as some of them also complained and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now all these things happened to them as examples. They were written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages come. Who is the them and who is the us that Paul is referring to? He's writing to the Corinthian church. So he's talking to the church and he's referring to them as Israel. So let not the church be like Israel. He's naming and numbering what happened to Israel. In the wilderness, complaining, grumbling, struck dead by the destroyer. He's talking about all the things that happened to them. But he says, why are these things recorded? It's recorded for our admonition. And one very senior pastor told me, why are you preaching from the Old Testament? You only have to read the writing of Paul
whenever Jesus quoted scripture, he obviously quoted the Old Testament. We just found out he quoted Hosea. I told you in Matthew 24, he quoted Daniel chapter 9. So, you know, you cannot understand the whole story if you don't get into understanding the temples, the presence of God, the glory of God, and then build it down to where we are today. So the church cannot be like Israel because we have examples. I just read the scriptures. It's written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the ages has come. That means the church is the end of the age. He's talking to the Corinthian church. Paul thought that the end would come in his time. That's why he said, we who are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. He thought it will happen in his time. Right. Look at the center thing in the bar. What is missing in the body of Christ in the temple? Is the presence of God missing? Is the glory missing? Is the power missing? Is the authority missing? You answer that question. I have already answered it for myself, and there's a big yes. It is missing. What do you do about it? Go home and come to church next Sunday. Everything is going to be all right. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be, will be. The future is not ours to see. Que sera, sera. Is that what the church does? You may not say that, but this is what we do. You know, I'm preaching this message with great difficulty because I said, Lord, what should we do? And you know, the immediate thought is, okay, discipleship, the programs, this one, missions, evangelizing. Lord, we have done all those things. I don't think there's anyone here who has not been through a discipleship program. If not in this church, in some other church. Has it done anything to your life? You don't need any program. You need Yeshua. You need Jesus. And you need to repent. I need to repent. Look at Romans chapter, the next verse. Romans 13 says, wake up. It's time to wake up. Arise from your slumber. Because what happened to Israel? Who were those Pharisees and scribes? They wrote the books of the law. They made copies. They interpreted the law. They were so well versed in the Bible. But see what happened to them. Jesus ultimately rebuked them. Look at the last point on the slide. The church must repent of the religion of the Pharisees. Spiritual blindness, spiritual complacency, missing the time of the Messiah. We're living with burnt offerings. We're bringing to church burnt offerings. We're living with burnt offerings. But you know what Romans chapter 12 says? I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Because your body is a temple, your body is also the sacrifice. And what Jesus said, in this place is someone who's greater than the temple. What was he telling the scribes and the Pharisees? Never mind your religious orders. Never mind the law that you just interpreted to me about harvesting grain for us to eat on the Shabbat. Never mind about healing a sick man, because that is my business. But I'm here to tell you, Jesus said, that there is someone standing here who's greater than all that you know. You have gone through two temples. You're looking forward to the third temple. You missed out on the death and resurrection, in other words. So you're looking forward to the third day. That's for Jerusalem, that's for Israel. But for the church, the third day has already happened. And there is no fourth day. There is no fourth day. Today, if God is speaking to your heart, do something about it. Do something about it. You cannot do the same old thing and expect a different result. What is blocking the church from moving in the power of God, in the authority of God? I'll tell you, you don't have to walk out and evangelize. The whole city will come here when the glory is here. The glory is not going to come on number 5 Ridgeway Place.
This is masonry, concrete. The glory is going to come upon the temples, which is your body. The same glory that came on the first temple and on the second temple, and which will come into the third temple for Israel, is already upon us. Because we are a temple of the Holy Spirit. God dwells within us. But you and I have to exit the temple. Get out of your bodies. Get out of your temples. In other words, self. Let not yourself dominate. You know, today, everyone in the church has a problem. There are issues. We don't like somebody. We don't like some issues. We don't like the pastor, or pastor doesn't like us. Or not Pastor Ron. I'm talking about that other pastor down the road. You know, things happen in churches. Things happen among families. Things happen everywhere. In teams, you put any team together, even in your office, there are people who fall out, you know, lots of issues, offense, all this is going on even in the church. It's because you and I are holding a stronghold on ourselves. Are you willing to let go? Are you willing to let the glory of God come into your temple?